morning, good evening, or good afternoon, depending on what side of the pond you're on, and welcome to an extra special edition of Across the Pitch. My name is Phil Kennedy, and I'm here with my co-host Tony Robinson today, where we welcome back the Wizard of Wham to Across the Pitch. And when I speak of the Wizard of Wham, that's because it's the voice behind the curtain that you hear throughout the entire stadium, none other than public address announcer Josh Adcroft. Welcome back to the show, Josh.
Oh, thanks for having me. So that is an absolutely sensational intro. the Wizard of the Wham.
Yeah. did you just write that, Phil, or did somebody write it for you? Is that one of your originals?
I kind of came up with that this morning. I was thinking, you know, you're the voice behind the curtain that gives that the message out to everybody in the stadium. And then I said, hey, Wizard of Wham, that's got a nice ring to it.
As long as you don't start calling me Dorothy, we're good with that comparison. Anyway.
Well, I think you'd be more like the Tin Man, you know.
Very good, very good. We're off track already, but it's a great pleasure to have you back, Josh, and because I think last time we were trying to get you on, you were stuck on a train somewhere, and so we're finally glad we've been able to catch up and. You know, we've got a few things we just wanted to talk to you, sort of a mid-season fan kind of catch up. And I guess we start off by just asking you what's your thoughts on the season.
But before we jump into the questions real quick, I just want to let everybody know, if they hadn't caught it before, we have had Josh on the show before. That was back in June of 2020, episode number 141, called From Bristol to Aki. So if you haven't had a chance to hear that, definitely check out that conversation with Josh as we really got into the ins and outs of PA announcing on that one. And also, we talked a lot about the Club 1968 on that one, and we'll probably touch on that at the end of the show. But I just wanted to make sure that if anybody hasn't heard that episode 141, to go back and give that a listen.
Well said, Phil, and I'm glad you got that in, because we didn't want to jump over that, and obviously recognize that Josh is a contributor from the past as well. And so just getting back to the season so far. And I mean, we all went into the season with sort of some expectations. Has your expectations been met, or have they been exceeded, or have they underachieved? What's your thoughts on so far, Josh?
I think they've been met so far. I think we've been very inconsistent. I think we've shown some real positives in our games, you know, in the way that we play, in our identity as who we are as Accrington Stanley. But with those positives, there's been some negatives as well. So I'd say that just the inconsistency, and I suppose that leads to frustration, because, you know, when we are on these bad spells, and, you know, last month in November was, you know, we were in a bit of a rut, and it looked like we couldn't buy a win for love nor money. And when you're on those, I think it is so frustrating, because you know what, you know, the team is capable of. You look at the individuals, we've got some real talented players in that squad. And I think, has that potential been, you know, realised this season? Maybe not quite yet. But it's exciting, you know, there's still half the season left to go. You know, we're not in a bad position in the league. You know, we're still flirting with, you know, the playoffs. And that was kind of, you know, my expectation from the start of the season. You know, let's you know, really aim for those playoffs or even the automatics. I think, you know, the squad that we've got, the players, the management team, the coaches, we're more than capable of being promotion contenders. And I think that's something, as a team, you know, we haven't looked out of place. You know, we could still become those, you know, promotion candidates. So that's what I think we are at the moment. Like I said, you know, it's exciting still.
Yeah, do you think going into the season, I know there was some fans that at expectations the way the season sort of ended last year and the way the with the recruitment and going into the season, I think some fans had a high expectation. And when I say that, I'm saying, you know, that really a playoff contender. But I mean, things have happened between now and then. And like you say, we're still knocking on the door. Do you think fans' expectations are a little higher this year in general?
They can be, yeah. But I think it's also deserved. I think the club deserves those high expectations and the fans deserve to want, you know, the best for the club. You know, the last few seasons or, you know, of us being in League One, we've shown that we're not just there to make up the numbers. We're a team there within our own rights. You know, obviously winning League Two got us up there. But I think the fans and probably the gaffer and Andy Holt as well themselves, you know, the expectations they set are high expectations, but they're also realistic expectations. And I think it pushes the players more knowing that, you know, the fans genuinely do believe that they're capable of promotion. You know, the fans aren't just saying that because they support the team and, you know, in reality, they'd be happy just to stay up. I think that the majority of fans this season do genuinely believe that we are, you know, promotion candidates and the team that we've gotten, not just the starting 11 this season, but I think this season more evidently than the past couple of seasons, but the whole squad as a whole, you know, we've been plagued by injuries, you know, players missing through one reason or another. And when you look at the squad as a whole, I don't think that the squad in, you know, the last 10, 15, 20 years has been as deep as it is now. You know, we've probably got three or four players you could easily fit into any position and come into the team. So, no, Tony, I think the expectations are, you know, are realistic. And maybe that's why we've seen different side of, you know, Accrington this season. When the going has got tough, you know, and the frustration has crept in, you know, with fans, it's again, you know, it's because we know how good these players can be and we know how good, you know, the club can be as a whole. And that's what has been frustrating at times when we don't realise that potential, you know, and when we, you know, some games have been a little bit sluggish, a little bit slow, you know, that's not Accrington Stanley and that's, you know, not the kind of identity that the gaffer and Jimmy want.
You know, I really couldn't agree more with everything that you're saying, and I think that we're very much on the same page, both in terms of what our expectations were going into the season, what we feel like in terms of what they've done so far. I know back at the beginning of the season, I had said that my goal was for them to, you know, challenge for the playoffs, you know, automatic promotion. That was always going to be tough, but I thought they could challenge for the playoffs. Ultimately, the biggest thing I wanted to see, though, is last year they finished 11th. I just wanted to see them at least improve on that. Right now, in 10th, they've done that by one position. Another thing that you mentioned was about us being at the halfway point for the season. A couple weeks ago, I had said that by the 23rd match, which is exactly halfway, I wanted to see us be at least 30 points because I felt like that would put us in a position where, you know, we're really not having to worry about the bottom end of the table. We really get to kind of look up at the second half of the season. The thing that concerns me there are a couple of concerns that I do have, and really the biggest one that I wanted to ask you about is goal difference. Right now, Accrington is a minus 10 in goal difference, which actually ranks 20th out of 24 teams in League One. They're by far the highest team in the table that has a negative goal difference. Do you find that to be any kind of a concern that, you know, maybe the peripherals in terms of the goal difference doesn't quite add up to the record that we have? When I see something like that, it's usually a bit of a red flag to me. Is that something that you're concerned about?
It's been on the mind, definitely, because, you know, we're not a team that usually concedes many goals. Over the last, you know, couple of seasons, it's been something that I know the guys have been really proud of, the defensive record. But I also think you can look too much into it. I know I've seen a lot of stats floating around social media with, you know, Sean McConville's the highest in the league, or I think even, you know, highest in the whole EFL for chance created. And I think you can read a lot into, you know, when you look at the table and see, you know, the goal against column and think, you know, we are one of the worst in the league. I'd rather be one of the worst in the league in 10th than one of the best in the league in 24th. In terms of, you know, goals conceded and that. So it is a concern. And I'd probably say it's more of a concern because we're not used to it. But when you look at the lads we've got, you know, specifically in defence and in goal, do those players give me concern? Probably not. Or, you know, definitely not. I think we've got, you know, pound for pound, probably one of the best back four or back three in the division. I think we've got probably two of the best young goalkeepers in the EFL.
Very much.
If we didn't have that, I'd be concerned. You know, if we didn't have that caliber of player, I'd probably look at it and go, hang on a minute, you know, when are we going to turn this around? You know, have we got the players to turn this around? But when you look at the players that we've got, you know, the likes of Toby, the likes of Ross, Knotts, I think it's a blip. And the good thing as well, in a sense, is that they've all, you know, like Coley said in his interviews, that probably, what, 75-80% of goals we conceded in November were down to individual errors. So it wasn't the case of it, you know, the players aren't talented enough or the players aren't good enough. It's just sloppy errors. And I think we almost needed to go through that bad spell to kind of get out of it. We needed to, you know, get that really out of our system and, you know,
It's been a very, very Jekyll and Hyde squad this year.
Definitely.
Sorry, but when you look at the back line. No, sorry, I was just going to say what Josh, I agree with Josh in this about the individual errors, and a lot of it has been some bad luck, and we paid for it. And in some, like last season, we weren't paying for any mistakes, and this year it just seemed to catch up with the squad. So you can make stats do a lot of things, but as Josh pointed out, the back grouping that they do, whether it's a four or a three, are solid, and they're the, you know, basically the same guys as last season, with the exception of Burgess gone. But I too have faith, and if they make a mistake, I don't think that I'm not sort of the sky is falling. It's just that the player makes some mistakes. Everybody does.
Yeah, definitely. To be fair, and you know, I might be wrong when I say this, I think it's probably done us the world of good that we've been on that bad run when we've had it. I mean, you know, you see comments on social media, and it's, you know, some people think it's all doom and gloom, and you know, the worst hockey team, or you know, the worst things are happening. We're 10th in League One. You know, we've got this real bad spell out of the way, you know, this season early.
Yeah.
You know, historically, maybe, you know, when we've had the bad weather and, you know, the pitches have struggled with, you know, the weather that we've had in December, we've, you know, had games called off, and we normally seem to go through a bad, you know, run Christmas time. We've had it a little bit early this year, and kind of the other side of that is historically, you know, we normally finish the season really strongly. I know that's something that, you know, the coaches really pride themselves on at Accia, especially in pre-season, you know, with them running over the sand dunes over, you know, Formby Way. And, you know, they kind of say to the players, you know, you'll really reap the benefits of this fitness later in the season. You know, we've been on a really bad run of form, but we're still, you know, we're not a million miles away from the playoffs. We're at the right end of the table. We're closer to the playoffs than, you know, than the relegation zone. And, you know, if someone said at the start of the season you'd be above Charlton, above Ipswich, above Bolton, above Morecambe, you'd have probably taken it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a good lead-in, because we're talking about the players and mistakes. And is there a player that has surprised you this year that you've said, well, that's, you know, that's a really good surprise? And is there a player that you'd like to see more of, given the opportunity, or are they the same player? What's your thoughts?
So the two surprising ones for me, and both of these are positive, are Liam Coyle and Tommy Lee, probably for two different reasons as well. You know, Liam's obviously not played a lot of men's football at all before coming to us. He's been a bit unlucky with injury, and for him to slot in that midfield in a really key position for us, you know, he went, when we're missing the likes of Sheamus and Matty Butcher and, you know, David Morgan, it's a really key position, that the way we play and how we play out from the back as well, that holding midfielder. You know, Sheamus has done it so well over the years. Scott Brown did it so well. You know, the little terrier in the midfield, you know, he wouldn't give opposition midfielders, you know, a yard. He'd be there around the ankles and, you know, doing anything he can to win the ball back. He's really, really impressed me this season as Liam Coyle. I think he's slotted in so well. And he came into the team, you know, when the team weren't playing the best, you know, and as a young lad, that must have been really hard for him to come into that without that experience of the men's game. You know, he's obviously been at Liverpool. He's been really highly rated at Academy. And, you know, we've said all along that step up from 23s football, you know, into men's football is such a jump, you know, regardless of how well you do at 23s level. And I've been really, really impressed by how he's conducted himself, how his passion for the game. You know, you see him cheering up the, you know, more experienced players during a game. He's really surprised me, because I knew he'd be good, I'd hoped he'd be good. You know, when you look at the reviews, you know, players like Steven Gerrard, you know, really speaking highly of him at the time of Liverpool. But the most pleasing and the most surprising is just how comfortable he looks in this division. Just looks like nothing phases him. And then the other side of that is Tommy Lee. And, you know, what an absolute breath of fresh air he's been. And, you know, he's done it a slightly different to Liam in the sense that, you know, he's been playing men's football down at Porchester, down at Bognor Regis. And, you know, he's had that taste of the physicality. And, you know, people have, you know, he looked really good in pre-season. He's got a bit of flair about him. And I was probably a little bit reserved about him. I probably, you know, looked at him and I think, well, you know, you don't want to have too much expectation on a young player, on a new player as well. And, you know, he came in and he looked good in the cup games. And, you know, and I see a lot of people calling for him to, you know, get a start in 11th place. And I was still a little bit reserved about that, you know. And then he's come into the team and he's just been fantastic. Very similar to Liam Coyle in the sense that it just looks like nothing phases him. He's just taken to the league. He's excited. You can see he's playing with a smile on his face. And his fitness, he covers, you know, every blade of grass. He's not afraid to do a bit of defensive work. You know, he's not afraid to put himself on the line a little bit. You know, he knows he's going to get knocked about, knocked off the ball a little bit. But just his attacking flair and his instinct and the goal the other day was the instinct that he had, the ball. I mean, I know this sounds sad, but I think I've watched it about 20 times. And just that ball to Colby and Tommy Lee's run to know that ball's going over Colby's head and he's going to get to it first. It's like he's been playing in this league for 10 years. It's just absolute sensational how he got on the end of that. And just that instinct is just, honestly, guys, it's watching it is just unbelievable. Watching him play, how he plays has just been so surprising.
I agree. Yeah, I agree with both your choices on that, Josh. And the one thing I'd say about Tommy Lee is I don't think he's got the email that says he's playing in League One. He's just going out there think he's playing in like where he come from. He's not overawed by anything. And like you say, he's been a breath of fresh air. And I think we've got a real good one in him and as well as Liam Coyle. So sorry, Phil, I just want to jump in there. I just stepped on.
Oh, yeah, no, that's great. Great stuff. And I couldn't agree more. And like you said, I mean, we've had so many injuries to key guys that we expected to play a big role this season, and having these guys jump in and be able to fill in is the only reason that we are where we're at the table right now. So I think all three of us are on the same page there. But going forward, we have the January transfer window coming up. We wanted to know, do you think that Accrington is looking at making some moves? What do you feel are the biggest needs? And, you know, just to throw it in there, of course, what do you think is going to happen with Neon Charles?
It's a tough one with Dion. I suppose it's tough because it's never happened to the club before. You know, obviously with the likes of Windass and Crooks, you know, they signed pre-contracts arranging in January, but the club kind of knew that. And I think, you know, you hear certain things with him. And look, all I'm going to say on that is, you know, as the gaffer said, you know, when he was initially dropped, we're not dropping someone that's scoring, you know, 10 goals in 20 games. You know, he probably by Dion's own admission, you know, he wasn't in the best of form. I'm a strong believer in staying true to your word. So if, you know, if he said, I'm going to sign a contract and hasn't, you know, it's the club have got to look after themselves at the end of the day. You know, they'll look after the players as best as they can. But, you know, number one is always going to be the club. It's frustrating because there's no winners for it. You know, it's not like Dion's winning by it or you know, the club are winning. No one's really winning from it. So that's the most frustrating thing. In the sense of January window, what do we need? Probably a magic pill that, you know, means no one gets injured. That'd probably be the kind of best signing we've had in a while. It's an interesting one because, you know, we seem to be screaming out for a naturally left-footed left-back. And, you know, I think maybe we've not had that, in essence, since Joe Jakobsen, you know, the lad who's at Wickham now. You know, he was probably our last naturally first team, you know, ready left back. But then yesterday, you know, we watched our 23s and Matty Carson, who's been playing for the 23s, has just got an absolute wonder of a left foot. And then you watch the under 18s and see young Conor O'Brien, the captain, you know, the right-footed lad playing at left-back and how well he does. And you think, wow, you know, if we can elevate them, if we can get, you know, maybe 50 EFL games behind them, you know, how good them two will be. I think a left-back maybe is still a priority, although, you know, obviously I know we're playing the three at the back. Maybe a left-back's not, you know, not needed. I think we need a bit more reinforcement up top. Obviously, you know, Dion, you know, maybe or more likely not going to play for us again. Obviously, Joel Mumongo's been ruled out probably now for the whole of the season. It's good that we've got Joe Hardy coming back. I know people have been excited by him in pre-season. And, you know, when you look at his pedigree and you look at the amount of goals that he's been scoring in 23's football, you hope that he can make the step up. But apart from that, you know, I don't think we're a million miles away. I really don't. I think that the squad we've got, you know, I think the key thing for us is getting the likes of, you know, your Joe Pritchard back, the players like Matty Butcher back, you know, players that just give you that little bit of creativity. And I suppose that probably goes back to the conceding goals as well. And, you know, the best form of defence is attack.
Yeah.
I mean, and if you've got players like, you know, Joe Pritchard on the ball, you're not going to concede. And I think that's, I mean, you know, really key.
With Butcher and Pritchard, I mean, you've got two guys there. We're coming into the season. If you'd have asked me to name who's the best player on the squad, I think both of those guys' names would have been in the discussion. So, I mean, getting one or both of them back in full health would just be, you know, a huge shot in the arm.
New signings, really, Phil. New signings.
Yeah, definitely.
One kind of concern that I've had, and I wonder if this is something that it crossed your mind at all, is with the season that Colby Bishop's having, and especially the form that he's been in lately, do you think there's any chance that, say, an offer that's too big to refuse comes in January on him? I'm just kind of concerned that, you know, we're short at striker to begin with, but, you know, say some big club comes in and, you know, offers a big 7-figure fee that's more than we can turn away. Do you think that that's something that we should be concerned about at all?
It's concerning in the sense that, like you say, how good Colby is playing, and, you know, rightly or wrongly, every player has got a price, you know, and that's, you know, it's got to be right for the club. And it's got to be right for Colby as well, you know, and judging, you know, from Colby's attitude and, you know, deadline day in August, he went and captained the team, you know, and scored, you know, I don't think the attitude for Colby in particular needs to be questioned by any stretch of the imagination.
Oh, no, not at all.
I think that he'd do the right thing for himself as well. Look, you know, we've probably got the best, or, you know, definitely have got the best manager, coaches, skates to an essence. You know, I say the term skates loosely because obviously, you know, we're not a club with riches, you know, with 30 men behind the scenes. But look, you know, we picked Colby up from non-league. We picked Dion up from non-league. Dion scored 20-odd goals last season, you know. So for all his, you know, maybe wrongfuls this season, let's not forget, you know, he's a talented boy and he knows where the back of the net is. You know, who better to then find the next Colby Bishop and Dion Charles than, you know, John Coleman? And I think, you know, if push comes to shove, you know, if we do lose Colby in January, you know, he's been absolutely superb for us. I think he's more than capable of playing in the Championship. And, you know, I don't think many players who've left us, you can say that for, or many players who've left us to go to, you know, in brackets, bigger clubs, have done themselves justice by doing so. I think there's probably only a small number of players, you know, the likes of Matty Pearson, Jordan Clark, you know, who've left us and have really progressed their careers since leaving us, perhaps. But I really do think that Colby Bishop is that type of player that, you know, he's just, you think of Colby Bishop when he came to Accrington and Stanley and then Colby Bishop now, you know, the amount that the boy has improved, you know, and that's down to his hard work, you know, that's down to, you know, the coach, the hard work. And I think with Accrington, a lot of it is a process, you know, we give these lads opportunities from non-league, from 23s football, you know, they use us as a platform. It benefits us because, you know, they you know, players pick us because they know it's a platform, you know. Players can earn more money elsewhere. They can, you know, maybe play at higher leagues than us, but they pick us because they know it's a chance for them to really put themselves on a platform. So it benefits the club. It benefits them as an individual. And, you know, players in the modern game, you know, they do move on. They move on for more money. They move on to challenge themselves. They move on for, you know, so many different reasons. And if that process comes to an end with Colby Bishop, you know, so be it. It's coming to the end for him for the right reasons, not the wrong reasons. And look, we start that process again. You know, we've already got Joe Hardy, we've got Josh Woods coming through, you know, a really exciting young lad who we signed from non-league, who's, you know, got traits to Colby Bishop already. And, you know, yes, it does worry us, you know, especially when you think about what's happening with Dion as well. And we're you know, possibly going to lose our two most senior strikers. But, you know, look, we're at Accrington and Stanley at the end of the day. And there's no one better out there than John Coleman, Jimmy Bell and John Doolan to find the next two.
Well, I think, you know, what you're saying about Colby, again, he's matured and grown so much and his attitude is totally 100% professional. And I think that showed when at the end of the window, when there was an offer came in, he could have made more money, I believe. And yet he, his decision was to stay at the club, and I think rightly so, to put himself about a bit more, and at some point he will progress up the ladder, and that a lot you say to do with the coaching staff because of the way they've grown him and the way he's applied himself, and you wish him all the best, and I hope he stays, but if he goes, the reserves they've got in place look strong, and like every other good player that leaves to better himself, we'd wish him well. But let's hope that's for a while yet. But just to touch on, I mean, you know, it's looking in the magnifying glass, crystal ball is what I was, what I'm thinking.
Hey, not the ruby slippers.
No, I got, I haven't got them on today. My wife's wearing them, so I haven't got them on today. What do you think as far as looking ahead? Do you still think we could challenge for a playoff position if we, with the bad spell behind us and players coming back, where do you see us at the end of the season, Josh?
Yeah, definitely. I don't think, you know, anything's changed since the start of the season in the sense that, you know, that the results we've been having haven't made us think, oh, you know, playoffs are a bit out of touch. Look, the two teams in the automatics now, Rotherham and Wigan, they're strong teams. You know, there's no doubt about that. You've got Sunderland's up there, your Wickham's up there. We can compete with any of these teams. You know, you put our 11 lads on the pitch with their 11 lads for 90 minutes. we can give anyone a game in this league. You know, we've proven that time and time again. You know, we've beaten, you know, the teams up there previously. It's, you know, you can't deny that. Can we do it consistently enough over the season is going to be the kind of testing point. Look, if we can get the players back that, you know, I think we've been missing, you know, and then have the likes of the lads that have come in still, you know, chomping at the bit to get on. Bowman's, you know, I think we can be up there. One negative for us this season, but, you know, again, it could be a blessing in disguise. The Cups, you know, it's not good to go out of the, you know, Cups as early as we have done. You know, obviously the FA Cup, the League Cup, and, you know, obviously the Papa John's Trophy, probably our best route to Wembley. That's frustrating. But, you know, at the end of the season, if we're up there in the playoffs, is anyone really going to be bothered if we've gone out of those cups? Probably not. You know, with the injuries that we've had and, you know, the games that we've got left to play, it could be a blessing in disguise. I think the league is always going to be the most important thing for us. And, you know, there's no one in this team that, in this division that we should fear. And, you know, pound for pound, the 11 lads we've got on the pitch and the squad as a whole, we can match anyone in this division. We've just got to go out there, prove that we can, prove that, you know, this is what we're capable of. And, yeah, it's exciting times. And obviously off the pitch as well is exciting times with the new hospitality and bars as well. So it's, the future's definitely bright.
The one thing I just wanted, wrapping up at my end, Josh, is with your involvement, match day experience, your involvement in the what goes on at the WAM, and we've seen a lot of really good comments come in from fans that have come to Stanley for the first time. Like I'm thinking Sheffield Wednesday, for example, and teams like that send a lot of big fan, you know, a big crowd, and the positive things they have to say, that their expectations are not generally high, but when they leave, they say, what a great experience. Do you experience that yourself during match day?
Oh, 100%. 100%. You know, in the marquee before the game, you know, seeing the fans mixing, you know, it's really good to see. And it just shows, you know, okay, we had the negativity with the Fleetwood game and, you know, what happened in the Fleetwood game. But, you know, you see fans of every other club jumping on saying, you know, like you say, what a great day out it is, what a great, you know, enjoyable, the whole experience, you know, not just what happens on the pitch, but, you know, for them as fans, you know, we have, you know, men, children, women, boys, girls, you know, people of various ages coming to watch us and everyone feels included. There's a real buzz around the ground. So, yeah, definitely, Tony, 100%. And you see Andy Holt, I mean, how many club owners would you see, you know, having a beer with fans before the game, giving out match badges before the game, being approachable, you know, he's an honest man, he'll always give you an answer. It might not always be the answer you want to hear, but he'll always be honest with it and he'll always, you know, have the club in his best interest. So definitely 100% the feel good factor around the club, with everything that's happening with the supporters trust, with the community trust as well. It's the three kind of arms for Atkinson Stanley with the football club, the supporters trust and the community trust coming together. It's a real feel good, not just around the club, but, you know, the town as well.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to, I got my trip planned for next August, September, and into October. And I'm really looking forward, obviously, to seeing the match, but to check out the new facilities and, I'm really looking forward to that. But it's been very insightful what you've told us today, Josh. We certainly appreciate it. And Phil, do you have a last question for Josh? It's I'll turn it over to the man behind the wizard, I guess.
I guess what we have here is so if Tony's the Tin Man, and that makes me the Scarecrow. Or
I'm not officially agreeing to the Tin Man, but it's your story, so you go with it.
Well, I figure, you know, up in Canada, it's cold. You're going to need your oil can.
Wrap it up, Phil.
Yeah, I think we've definitely digressed a bit, but Josh, actually, what I was going to ask you is if you you had anything to add that we hadn't asked you about. I know that you were involved in a lot of things like Club 1968. What's going on with Club 1968? I don't think we'd ask you about that at all.
It's going really well. Yeah, we've got, we've given away £20,000 to wow. the lucky Stanley fans over the past 18 months or more than that. You're putting me on the spot now with my maths, aren't you? £27,000, I think we've given away now since we started Club 1968. All to, Stanley fans, people that contribute to the club. We raise good money for the supporters trust that, enhances the match day experience for fans. All the money that we raise from running it goes back into the club in various guises. So that's really positive. We've done some live draws with it. Logistics have meant we've had to do some pre-recorded ones as well. We've got some really big plans for 2022 with that as well. We started at the start of the season when the weather was nice, so we were doing some live draws on the pitch, and we had various ex-players. We had two ex-goalkeepers coming in, drawing them as well.
Oh yeah,
I saw we've got that. Some more ex-players coming up as well to do some more draws. So it's really exciting. Club 1968. We've got our trust AGM tomorrow with a John and Jimmy Q&A session as well, so that's really exciting as well, because they're usually really good nights, the Q&A's. Obviously John and Jimmy, Dave Burgess, Andy Holt, the people that come to them and answer the questions. They'll always give an honest, open answer to any question. So yeah, there's some real positive things happening around the club, and it's probably not a better time to be an Accrington Stanley supporter at the moment.
Well, I don't think that there's any team in any sport in the world that there's a better time to support than Accrington Stanley. Because like you said, I mean, it's just from the top down, guys like Andy and Dave Burgess, and then, of course, John and Jimmy. I mean, when you start with four guys like that, and they're the ones that are running the business end and the football end of the club, respectively, good things are going to happen.
Yeah, you couldn't have put it better there, Phil. There's so much talent in that club, be that, the likes of John Miles and Duncan, in the academy, Matty Donnelly, the physio, the ground staff, everyone, there's some real talented people at this club. And like you said, who better to, oversee the whole thing than John, Jimmy, Andy and Dave?
Yeah, and all of them have been on the show, and like you said, I mean, the biggest thing about Andy is just his honesty and the fact that he'll tell things like they are, and you never have to worry about that what he's telling you isn't what's really on his mind.
the one thing I'll just add on to what we just said about the gentleman leading the club. Right from Andy down to John Doolin and everyone in between, and they've really helped out our show. And we're going to be releasing some celebrations about a milestone that we've achieved across the pitch. And every one of those gentlemen that we've mentioned have agreed to participate in our celebration. So I want a big shout out to everybody, Andy. And all the rest, John, Jimmy, John Doolin, and Dave Burgess. Stay tuned, because we got some stuff coming out about a milestone that we've achieved. And Josh, you've been a part of this ride, and your insightfulness today has been tremendous. And we thank you for your time.
No, thank you both as well. It's exciting to hear about what you guys have got coming up, because the podcasts are great and you two are great as well. So yeah, long may this continue.
Well, thank you so much, Josh, for coming on the show with us today. And everything has just been brilliant. And a huge shout out to Tony. I'm not going to give anything away more than what he's already started talking about, but he has just done tremendous work on putting together this little celebration. And Getting all of the gentlemen he mentioned involved, as well as some other very, very, very special guests. And, you know, we were very excited to celebrate this little milestone that we have coming up. And as we always finish up with, is the famous On Stanley On. So if everybody's ready, we'll go on three, one, two, three. On Stanley On.
Cheers, Josh.
Our pleasure. Thanks, chap.
Have a great one.
See you, Josh.
Cheers, boys. See ya. Take care. Bye-bye.